Everybody, Lisa Romano here at the Breakthrough Life Coach, and today we're going to be talking about the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. I think it's really important that we talk about the hypothalamus, that we understand the pituitary, and we understand the adrenals in relationship to trauma and in relationship to how we experience stress. First thing that I want to explain to everybody is that the sympathetic nervous system is automatic. And the sympathetic nervous system is always activated. And when we experience a fear or stress, the sympathetic nervous system's job is to alert the fight or flight response. In a normal situation, let's say you're driving down the highway and you see a car in your peripheral vision, let's say to the left, and it's coming at you really close and you get nervous and there's a fear response. In that moment, what will happen is your sympathetic nervous system will become activated. It's on automatic pilot all the time. It will become activated and that will activate your stress response. When the sympathetic nervous system gets activated, norepinephrine floods the bloodstream. The norepinephrine that floods the bloodstream then activates the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus releases CRF, and I just want to make sure I pronounce it correctly, which is corticotropin releasing factor. And when this happens, the CRF then stimulates the pituitary gland to secrete and release adrenal corticotropic hormone. The pituitary, once it releases this hormone, then this hormone activates the adrenals. The adrenals then release steroids like cortisol and glucocorticoids. Once these glucocorticoids and cortisol is dumped into the bloodstream, something amazing happens. The body is preparing for the flight or fight response, right? So when we experience, let's say we are afraid we're going to get attacked, what happens is this amazing system, this mind-body connection that is just absolutely incredible, is all taking place to help us free up glucose that's been stored in the body. Now, the reason we want glucose to be freed up is so that we have the energy, so that our muscles are flooded with enough glucose that we're able to fight off an attacker. So the three things that happen once our adrenals have been activated and these this cortisol has been released into the bloodstream and sugar or glucose is being freed up is we experience increased heart rate. And like I said earlier, it actually frees up glucose in the body. The third thing that happens, which is amazing, is it actually helps turn the fight or flight response off. Hippocampus has amazing receptors. It's full of receptors that take on this cortisol and they are called glucocorticoid receptors. So the hippocampus has GR receptors, right? And when the hippocampus is flooded with this cortisol, it then turns this response off. Now, the reason the body wants to be able to shut down this stress response is so that it can go back into homeostasis. So this HPA axis that we're talking about, its main job is to help us regulate the stress response in the body. And when cortisol is released, that is supposed to shut the response down. It's actually a saving mechanism. So let's talk about the systems of the brain, okay, involved in this whole process. The hypothalamus is a region of the forebrain that connects the autonomic nervous system with the pituitary gland. So your hypothalamus helps regulate homeostasis through regulation of sleep, through the regulation of your emotions, through body temperature, hunger, and thirst. So it's very important that we understand that a hypothalamus is trying to regulate your body so that you can thrive and not only survive. So when there is a dysregulation in the HPA axis, it's going to be very difficult for our internal body systems to unfold properly and to function properly. Our immune system goes down. Some of us have problems with IBS. There are fertility issues that are related to dysregulation of the fight or flight response. So we have to think about this idea that when our ability to calm down has been corrupted in some way through the dysregulation of this fight or flight response, there's going to be a disruption of everything beautiful that is supposed to happen in the body. So normal immune responses, normal heart rates, normal blood pressure. So it's important that we recognize that an interruption in our ability to calm ourselves down is going to make it very difficult for our bodies to unfold beautifully and normally. We're going to have problems with being able to sleep, with being able to control our body temperature. We may be hungry, more hungry all the time, or we may not be hungry at all. And like I said earlier, we could have stomach upset and even problems with fertility. So the pituitary gland is a pea-sized gland, and it is near the base of your brain, and it is considered the major gland that helps regulate the other endocrine glands. The adrenal glands, they sit on top of your kidneys, and they produce hormones like adrenaline and cortisol. Altogether, these three parts work as a team to regulate how your body responds to stress. They help regulate and monitor energy, immunity, motivation, and even your metabolism. So HPA dysfunction, some of you have written me and asked me to do a video on HPA dysregulation or dysfunction. And this happens when the body has become desensitized to stress hormones. And this is actually a protective response to conserve hormone production needed to produce glucose. So think about somebody who's in a chronic stress situation, a child who's experiencing trauma, and they know that they can't fight or flee, what happens? They shut down, right? So think about dissociation, think about numbing out, or think about a child's system that has been flooded, right? Learned helplessness. Is this HPA axis dysregulation associated with learned helplessness, where so many of us stop trying to get out of difficult situations? We think that this is our plot in life, that we're always going to be married to abusive people. We hear ourselves saying we're never going to get out. Is this all related to us learning very early on that there is no escape? So the HPA dysfunction or dysregulation is actually the body's protective mechanism. So what the body is trying to do is essentially it's saying that there's a stress, there's cortisol, but we can't get out of this situation. We haven't figured out how to stop this stressor from coming at us. So let's stop, let's shut this response off for when we really need to tap into glucose and we really need to fight something off. So it's actually the way the body is preserving its ability to be able to secrete glucose when it really needs it. So the rundown is CRH in the hypothalamus triggers ACTH in the pituitary, which then triggers glucocorticoids in the adrenals. So again, it is the hypothalamus, pituitary, and adrenal glands. But when the stress response gets stuck, meaning chronic stress is your life, the body will not be able to restore balance, so the body becomes less sensitive to the stressors in your life. Recently, they did a study that said that most people have an activated fight or flight response up to 20 to 30 times a day, which think about what's happening inside our bodies when our bodies are being essentially chemically forced to dump glucose, right? This glucose dumping could be related to the rise in type 2 diabetes. So essentially, the hypothalamic, pituitary, and adrenal axis is basically how the brain, the nervous system, the adrenals, and the endocrine system all work together to help you deal with stressors in your life. And they're helping to regulate the fight or flight response system. What's supposed to happen is we're supposed to have a fight or flight response, but the body's supposed to very quickly return to balance. This system is a beautiful design. It's the way we know that our beings were designed for survival. And so there's nothing wrong with the design. What is wrong is what's happened in our environments that has affected or helped to dysregulate the way this works, the way the HPA axis works. So I want to read you a little bit about this PubMed abstract that I found that is very, very interesting. And the title of it is Effects of Childhood Trauma on Cortisol Levels in Suicide Attempters and Ideators. So the objective, suicide is a global health issue. Dysregulated hypothalamic pituitary adrenal or the HPA axis activity as measured by cortisol levels has been identified as one potential risk factor for suicide. Recent evidence has indicated that blunted cortisol reactivity to stress is associated with suicidal behavior. The current study investigated whether childhood trauma was associated with blunted cortisol reactivity to a laboratory stressor and resting cortisol levels in suicide attempters and ideators. So I won't go into the whole thing, but essentially they took 160 participants and they were recruited and grouped according to history of previous suicidal attempt, suicidal ideation, or as control participants. Participants completed background questionnaires, including the childhood trauma questionnaire, before completing a laboratory stress task. Cortisol levels were assessed at rest and during the stress task. So they deliberately stressed the participants and then tested their cortisol levels. So these were the results. The highest levels of childhood trauma were reported in those who had attempted suicide, 78.7%, followed by those who thought about suicide, 37.7%, and then those with no suicidal history, which was 17.8%. Moreover, regression analysis showed that childhood trauma was a significant predictor of blunted cortisol reactivity to stress and resting cortisol levels, such that higher levels of trauma were associated with lower cortisol levels in those with suicidal history. Family history of suicide did not interact with the effect of childhood trauma on cortisol levels. Their conclusion: these results indicate that childhood trauma is associated with blunted HPA axis activity in vulnerable populations in adulthood. The challenge for researchers is to link trauma, cortisol, and suicide risk, and to investigate whether the effects of childhood trauma on cortisol levels are amenable to psychological intervention. So a lot of people think that cortisol is bad. Cortisol is not bad. When the adrenal glands secrete cortisol, what is supposed to happen is the hippocampus is supposed to absorb this cortisol, and that is our shutoff system. So that is when our brain is like, okay, shut down now, okay, relax now, and that shuts off this fight or flight response. What happens, though, in so many of the cases is that so many of us are triggered throughout the day, all day. Many of us are highly overreactive, so we're stuck in this response. Some of us don't have enough response. We're dysregulated to the point where we have, very little response to stress. We're dissociated. We're depressed. We feel numb. And like I said earlier, that could be those of us who, and I think my mom was that person, where she was just like, I'm stuck. I'm married to this person. I'm not getting out. I'm old. I'm never going to go anywhere. What would life be without him? I think that was her state of being, just stuck. And that goes back to childhood trauma, being sexually abused when she was young, adult children of alcoholics as parents, you name it, like very, very stressful childhood. Cortisol is not the problem. And like I said earlier, once the adrenals secrete cortisol, the hippocampus with all its receptors for cortisol is supposed to shut this response down. So what does this mean? Like, for those of us who are trying to understand ourselves, right? The one thing I think that a lot of us get caught up in is we're trying to compare ourselves to other people. So we look at our friends and we're like, how come that bothers me and it doesn't bother her? One of the things that we have to understand about trauma is that there's something called stressor perception. So that means that all of us react to stimuli differently. God forbid, sexually molested in your home, this is where you're supposed to feel safe. So your body will register that as trauma much higher than if you were abused, let's say, on vacation, or you were abused outside the home, right? So your brain knows and your body knows psychologically, that this bed in this house should be a safe place, and it's not. And so your brain is going to triage that stressor very, very high. So similarity to a particular traumatic event or your ability to consider your similarity to somebody else that who has experienced a traumatic event. So let's say you hear about the little girl next door who was abused by a man at a playground. If you identify with the little girl next door, then that is going to be high in terms of how you triage that stress. Another way that we triage stress and events is our level of powerlessness, our level of helplessness. So obviously the younger we feel, right? And that's why I think that trauma that occurs in infancy must be appreciated, because infants are completely vulnerable and powerless, completely, right? And we don't pay enough attention to what happens to children before the age of one when they are absolutely defenseless, but we should. And so there is evidence that suggests, and I will be interviewing an amazing doctor soon whose studies have essentially led him to believe that trauma that happens before the age of one is extremely serious, although so many people think, ah, what's this baby going to remember? It does matter at what age we experience a traumatic event. It absolutely does. In a study that they did with rodents, they exposed rodents to maternal separation during infancy, postnatal, 2 to 14 days old. And they found that this can lead to dysregulation of the receptors that are in charge of regulating the HPA axis activation, which resulted in a hypersensitivity to stress responses. So they take these baby rodents away from their mothers, and they find out that there is an absolute dysregulation, making the rats or the rodents more sensitive to stress. It's important that we recognize that those of us with PTSD are more sensitive to stimuli than people who aren't. And that's not something that we should be ashamed of, at least not anymore. It's also important that we recognize that when the brain believes that, you know, eliciting a stress response is futile, I'm not going to be able to get out of this situation, why should I even try? This is called hypocorticalism, where there is an absolute suppression of the response, like, what, no one's going to be able to help me, I can't get out of this, so I'm very flat. So what the study that I shared with you proves that those of us who suffer from suicidal ideation, who think about suicide, have tried to attempt suicide, you know, our cortisol levels are actually lower than other people. And this could be all related to, and they're saying it is, that there's a dysregulation of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. This is because there's a suppression of the stress response. And most likely, you know, it's due to this idea that children who suffer from childhood trauma have this feeling that they can't escape it. You know, if you're a child that's stuck in a traumatic home, you know that you can't get out of it. You know that you need these people. So these children are not having proper stress responses. Does that make them more susceptible to being abused in the future? I really do hope that this information has found you well, has found you curious, and has piqued your interest into figuring out what happened to you and why it is you may be overly reactive or underreactive. And for those of you who have noticed or have gone to a doctor and you realize that your cortisol levels are really, really low, that is an indicator that your body just essentially came to the conclusion that outputting these chemicals did not alleviate the stress response. And essentially, your body, your divine body, is basically trying to preserve you and preserve your ability to output glucose when and if you truly ever need it. And I just think that's amazing. To know that we're designed for survival, to know how magnificent our bodies are, it's just awesome. It just makes you feel so much more connected to Creator, and it makes you appreciate what your body is. And I hope that it absolutely helps you appreciate the mind and the body and how the mind affects the body. I hope it also helps you to become more curious about the unconscious mind. Know that we are more unconscious than we are conscious, and that our body has kept a score and is keeping a score, and that the way to unlock our lives and the way to gain control over our emotions is through deliberate thought and to education and to learning and to putting all this stuff into practice. It's been my humble pleasure to present this information to you today. Namaste. Bye for now.